So we're talking about in your life, is it finished or not? And tonight we want to start, I think it's part three, our base scripture being John 19 and 30 in Hebrews 4, 1 through 10, if I'm not mistaken, yes, 1 through 10. But we was talking on Sunday about how to conquer the spirit of unbelief. And unbelief, we said on Sunday, as the Lord gave us to say, unbelief you will find is probably one of your greatest enemies that you have to fight. And we all deal with it. I don't have time to go back over everything God said Sunday, but one of the things that stands out to me that came out Sunday was the father came to Jesus and said, I need you to help me with my son. I brought him to your disciples and they could not heal him. What's the problem? What's going on? He's supposed to be your group. This supposed to be your evangelistic team. It's supposed to be your elders. It's supposed to be your people who are walking with you and walking closely with you. And so we're saying the father said, I don't understand why they could not heal him. Jesus said, bring him to me. Bring him to me. Are y'all hearing me okay? Bring him to me. Somebody said we got some crackling noise. Am I coming through okay? Y'all give me some feedback in the chat. But he said, bring him to me and I heal him. But the father said, Lord, I believe. He said, I believe. He said, but I need you to deal with or help me with my unbelief. So we found out Sunday that you can have unbelief and belief at the same time, or you can have faith and unbelief at the same time. So we need to know how to deal with this unbelief. How? Because we don't want to be unbelieving believers. We don't want to be going to church every Sunday. We don't want to be quoting scriptures and running by the church and shouting and praising God and speaking in tongues and yet go home unbelieving. Go home with unbelief and not see the manifestation that God has given us because we operate in unbelief. So we need to understand that we have to know how to deal with or arrest that unbelief. So we found out Sunday that the first thing God said to us, we must consistently and constantly engage in spiritual rehabilitation therapy as it relates to our mind. Spiritual rehabilitation therapy. Spiritual rehabilitation therapy. S-R-T. We must engage in it. What do you say? We must learn how to cast down imagination. We must learn how to pull down. We saw in the Amplified that's arguments and reasoning and theories and things that come against the word of God and every high thing. And we found out Sunday that unbelief is a high thing. So we have to pull down this unbelief. Because I'm telling you, you'll start out good and you'll be believing God and you'll leave church on high, or you'll leave out of prayer on high, or you'll leave out of reading the scripture on high, and before nightfall, y'all ain't talking to me, you'll find out that you're struggling to continue to hold on to your faith. My Bible says that we should cast not away our confidence in what God said, because our confidence has great recompense or reward. Y'all ain't talking to me. The Bible said Abraham, Romans 4, did not stagger at the promise. He wasn't struggling to believe God. Y'all all right? Yeah, he got caught up in that situation with listening to his wife and trying to get the baby to come through Hagar. But the Bible said he didn't stick at the promise. So that means to tell me he was doing something, listening at somebody else, but he yet believed God. But he was trying to please his wife. Y'all ain't saying that. And sometimes, I don't know how I got on this, but we'll mess up because we're trying to please other people instead of pleasing God. Y'all all right? My Bible said it's better to obey God than to obey man. I'm preaching real good already. So we must learn how to cast down these imaginations. Rehabilitation is care that can help you get back or keep or improve ability that you need for daily life. So that is key. We must do this every day. We cannot wait to just Sunday. Y'all hear me? We cannot just wait to Bible study. I'm telling you, you have to get disciplined. I'm trying to put these notes up on the screen for anybody that want to see them. But we have to get disciplined in the word. I'm telling you, Bible said, man don't live by bread alone, but he lives by the word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And you got to get in that word. I don't care if that word is in a psalm. I don't care if that word is in meditation. I don't care if that word is reading the words off the page. I don't care if this is just somebody preach, but I'm telling you, you got to make it necessary. You got to make it absolutely necessary that I engage in word every day, because that word comes to combat that what your flesh start telling you. Are y'all all right? Unbelief comes because of our entertainment, arguments, and theories and reasoning. And so unbelief began to come as a result of us considering the fact. Y'all didn't get that. That's a different than between considering the facts and considering the truth. Y'all all right. Yeah, the fact might be that I'm sick. The fact might be that I have cancer. The fact might be that I have this. The fact may be that I have that. But the truth is, I am healed by his stripes. Y'all ain't talking to me. And my Bible said, you shall know the truth. It didn't say you shall know the fact. Y'all ain't talking. The Bible said, Romans 4:19, that Abraham considered not the deadness of Sarah's womb, nor him being 100 years old. Are y'all all right? Abraham understood and knew exactly what was going on with his body and what was going on with his wife's body. But the Bible says he considered it not. Y'all all right? And God told me to tell somebody to consider not. Consider not how old you are. Consider not your credit report. Consider not your finances. Consider not how far you went in school. Consider not what family you came in. Y'all listen. I'm telling you, you got to pull this stuff down, because the enemy is the accuser of the brethren. And he will remind you of things that's in your past. Y'all ain't saying that. He will remind you of stuff that's already covered under the blood. Are y'all all right? He will remind you that you're nobody. You came from the wrong side of the track. You're the black sheep of the family. Y'all ain't saying nothing. But I'm telling you, you got to deal with that thing every day, because the longer you entertain these thoughts, the more you disbelieve God. I said, the more you're engaged in unbelief. So every day, I have to do warfare. I have to do therapy. I have to say, no, devil, I hear what you say, but God's word trumps what you say. God's word overrides what you say. Are y'all all right? God's word, let every man be a liar, and let God's word be true. Are y'all okay? So he said, tell them, consider not. Stop talking about it. Stop even rehearsing in your mind what is your present state. Your present state is temporary. Your present state is subject to change. Your present state, my God, is just where you are now. It's just where you are now. Don't get bogged down in where you are. Where you are now is going through. You're supposed to be going through. He never told you to park here. I try to tell you Sunday. The David say, yea, though I walk through. Yea, though I walk through. Not yea, though I park here. No, yea, though I walk through. So whatever you're going through, you should be walking on through it. Y'all ain't saying nothing. But if you start considering, I heard the Holy Ghost, that's what happened with Peter in the boat. And Peter, my God, Peter started walking on the water. Peter was doing the impossible. Peter was going against nature, going against gravity. Are y'all all right? But because he started considering the wind, started considering what was going on around him, markets, you ain't careful, you'll start considering what's going on in the economy. You'll start considering what's going on in the schoolhouse. You'll start considering what's going on your job. You'll start considering what's going on in your body, what's going on in your finances. Are y'all all right? And you'll miss God because you start focusing and causing that thing to be a hot thing. Are y'all all right? Y'all all right? Y'all still here? Y'all still with me? Yeah. So he said, consider not. I know it's there, and I'm not telling you to act like it's not there. I'm telling you to speak differently. Call things that be not as though it were. Call your body healed. Call your body delivered. Call your children saved. Call your house paid off. Are y'all all right? Woo! Because we have the power to, glory to God, I feel the Holy Ghost. We have the power to decree a thing, and it shall be established. God said, whatsoever you can have, whatsoever you say. But the reason sometimes we have what we have, because we're not saying what God said. We're saying what we see. No, we're saying what we see. Yeah, Mr. Darlene did say, do you see it? But she wasn't talking about in the natural. She was talking about in the spirit realm. We got to see what God sees. That's why he asked Jeremiah, what do you see? And I'm not going to perform it until you see what I see. As long as you keep seeing what you see, you ain't ready for me to perform it yet. Y'all ain't saying that. But how about coming to agreement with God? Sometimes we try to find a person on the earth to come in agreement. But how about coming to agreement with God? That's what confession is. Confession is to come into agreement with God and say what he say. Y'all ain't saying. Oh, I'm getting too happy. Yeah. Say what he say. Somebody say, say what he say. Somebody say what he say. Not say what you see, but say what he say concerning what you see. Are you all right? Okay. We're trying to calm down just a little bit. All right, point number two. How do I combat the spirit of unbelief? We must fast often. Now, I'm gonna stop right there and give you time to breathe, and give you time to catch your breath, and give you time to come back and tune back into the Bible class. Because fasting has become a curse word in the church. When I was growing up, fasting was normal. Fasting was often. Fasting was a part of being saved and walking this thing out. But now we've kind of put fasting on the shelf. You don't hear much talk about fasting. You don't hear too many churches talking about shut-ins and fasting. But if we're going to come back, stay with me, the spirit of unbelief, we must fast often. In this same text, in Mark chapter 9, when the Father brought the Son to Jesus, the disciples asked Jesus privately why we couldn't cast the devil out. And Jesus didn't embarrass them in front of the Father. He waited till on the sideline, and he said, let me tell you something. This kind. Mark 9:28-29, right there now. Yeah, this kind come only by fasting and praying. And you know, when I was growing up, I don't know if they taught it wrong or I understood it wrong, but they led me to believe that the fasting and the praying was to help get rid of the spirit that was on the man's son. I found out differently. The fasting and the praying was to get rid of the unbelief. Y'all ain't saying that thing. Because the unbelief was coming up out of their flesh. And fasting helped you to get control of your flesh so you can tune in to God. Are y'all all right? Woo! The fasting was not to give them power to cast out the dumb spirit. Okay. Need some scripture. Luke 10:19 said, behold, I give you power to cast out devils and to walk upon serpents and power over the enemy. So that tells me he wasn't telling you to fast for power. You already got power. Somebody said, I already got power. Put it in the chat. I already got power. But could it be that I got power, but I still have unbelief? And my unbelief is a short-circuiting. Oh, God, I hear you. This ain't in my notes. But the unbelief is short-circuiting. I don't know if I'm saying that word right. short-circuiting the power that's in your life. Y'all all right? And so he said, he told the disciples, you need to get in prayer and you need to fast so you can bring that flesh under subjection so the power of God can have free road, free course, and free reign in your life. Y'all all right? Fasting helps to gain control of the flesh because the flesh is always anti the spirit. Are y'all all right? Are y'all all right? Are y'all still here? Y'all still breathing? Y'all still with me? Galatians 5 and 16 real quick. We in Bible study, right? Galatians 5 and 16. Galatians 5 and 16 says, it says this. I'm getting there. I want to make sure I quote this right. This I say to him, walk in the spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth, or is contrary against the spirit, and the spirit is contrary against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. You cannot operate in the power that you're supposed to operate in as a believer if you're going to let unbelief run rapidly in your life. Is that right? I just ask you, is it finished or not? Is it, are you walking in the finished work? Are you walking in the power that you've been given? You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost, Acts 1:8, has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. Why are we not witnesses? Could it be that we operated in too much unbelief? So the power that we've been given as having been recipients of the Holy Ghost, could it be that we're not operating in the power because we don't have a grip on that unbelief? Are y'all all right? So we got to fast. Don't wait on the pastor to put you on a fast. Put your own self on a fast. Put your own self on the altar. Put your own flesh on the altar and tell God to burn it up. Y'all ain't saying that to me. Tell God to help you with that unbelief. Be real like the boy father. He said, Lord, I believe, but you got to help this unbelief. So I'm finna turn down this whopper. I'm finna turn down this biggest shake and the biggest fry. I'm finna turn down, my God, these chicken nuggets and these chicken fingers. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I'm finna turn down the milkshake. I'm finna turn down the ice cream. I'm finna turn down the pizza. Are y'all all right? So I can get in prayer and get control of this flesh so I can operate in the power that you've given me. Are y'all all right? Y'all still here? Y'all still here? Y'all still here? Woo! I don't know if y'all still here. I've been thinking y'all done tuned me out. Glory to God. But it's okay. I'm going to preach this word. Yeah. So we must fast often. He told the disciples, look, this kind, I heard your Holy Ghost. The Lord said, we will mess around and be embarrassing to the kingdom. He's saying this to me now. We will mess around and be embarrassing to the kingdom because we operate in unbelief. And things we should be able to deal with in the spirit will cause us some concern and problem if we don't get control of this unbelief. All right. We're supposed to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. We're supposed to lay hands on demons and they're supposed to come on out. They're not supposed to stay there after we done prayed and shook him a shot and hock him a high, and he coming on a Honda and he coming in a Cadillac and he coming in a Mercedes and he coming in a he's coming, glory to God, hallelujah. He's coming, hallelujah, or whatever he's coming on. But I'm trying to tell us, we need to understand that we can mess around here and cause shame to the kingdom because that we're supposed to be able to handle, we can't handle because we haven't dealt with it unbelief. I know I ain't going to get no amens on that, but it's okay. It's okay. I'm not talking about just pastors and preachers and apostles and bishops. Every believer supposed to be believing and operating in the power of God. Because he didn't say, behold, I give the elder power. Behold, I give the apostle power. Behold, I give the bishop power. He said, behold, I give you power. Y'all quiet. And when he said, you shall receive power, anybody that received the Holy Ghost received power. Are y'all okay? So he went, this ain't got to do with title. This ain't got to do with fivefold ministry. It got something to do with being a believer. You supposed to every believer should be able to lay hands on the sick. Y'all quiet now. Every believer should be able to cast out devils. Every believer should be able to take up service. Are y'all all right? That's what the Bible said. Okay. So, but could it be that we're operating in unbelief and we don't see what we should see? And then we want to go take the person that we should have been able to deal with to the elder, to the intercessor, to the bishop, to the first lady. What's wrong with you? When they met you, they supposed to meet God. When they saw you, they supposed to saw the Father. Y'all ain't when they saw you, they came to church. Oh, y'all quiet. Let me try to get you to come to church so the elders can lay hands on you. What's wrong with your hand? What's wrong with your power? I know what's wrong with you. You're still dealing with unbelief. But if you get control of the unbelief, you can lay hands on them. By the time they get to church, they already here. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Woo! I feel the Holy Ghost on me tonight. Oh, point number three. How do we combat the spirit of unbelief? That's what I'm dealing with. Point number three. We must engage in spiritual warfare by increasing our meditation on the Word of God. Oh, another cuss word in the church. We ain't got time to meditate on the Word. We're too busy trying to see who on Facebook and who got married and who going with who and who cussing who out and who saying something to who and who got on this and who went on vacation and where they went and who went with them. And we're trying to keep up with this and keep up with that on the TikTok and all the other top. And we got time to meditate on the Word of God. But my Bible said, Psalms 1 and 2, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. And it said, in his law doth he meditate day and night, not just on Sunday, not just on Tuesday. If then, but he said day and night. Every day, I'm engaging in meditation. Every day, Joshua 1 and 8 says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you should meditate on it day and night, and then shall you prosper, and then shall you have good success. Are y'all all right? Could it be that we're not prospering like God wants us to prosper or having the success we want to have because we refuse to meditate, and so we leave room for unbelief? Let me tell y'all what God told me. What you meditate on becomes what you speak about and what you eventually become. I'm going to say that again. What you meditate on becomes what you speak about and what you eventually become. Need some scripture? Proverbs 23:7. As a man thinketh in his heart, as a man meditate in his heart, so is he. The Amplified Bible says, so he becomes. So could it be that I am what I am today based on what I have meditated on in the last 6 to 8 to 12 months? Well, y'all quiet in here. Could it be that I have unbelief because I've been meditating on something outside of the Word of God? Because when I meditate on the Word, it gives me power. It ignites my power. It ignites my faith. Okay. He said we go from faith to faith. And he said add to your faith. So when I get that Word and meditate on it, it caused my faith to increase. It caused my faith to grow. It caused my faith to move. It caused my faith to jump. Okay. That's why I heard the Holy Ghost. That's why when Mary embraced Elizabeth, he said the baby jumped in her womb. God ain't saying that. It's something about when Word meet Word. It's something about when you get with light spirit. It's something about when you meditate and get in the presence of God. It'll cause your baby to jump. It'll cause your dream to jump. Are y'all all right? It'll cause your faith to jump. It'll cause your hope to rise. Are y'all all right? Let me tell you what God told me during the testimony service. He said this. I wrote it down quick as I could. He said this during the testimony service. He said, what you meditate on becomes what you believe. And what you believe becomes what you manifest. I wrote it down. So could it be that we're not seeing manifestation because we're not meditating on it till we believe it? So this is how we become unbelieving believers. Because I think I heard Elder Collins say, yeah, I write it down, but I put it on the shelf. I thank God for her transparency because she just spoke for the for a couple of us. Don't judge me. No. I'm just through this, baby. Because you don't have the manifestation you believe it for. I think I heard Ella Maria say that she was convicted Sunday. Yeah. That's something. Do you really see it? Do you really see it till you believe it? Do you really say it till you believe it? What you meditate on becomes what you believe. And what you believe becomes what you manifest. So could it be that we haven't been manifesting because we have not been believing because we have not been meditating? Hello, Kabisa. That's why. We don't have time for that. We too big a hurry. We got to go here. We got to go there. We got every day full to the time we get up, to the time we lay down. Every weekend is filled. When is that time for God? When is that time for meditation? How much time do you meditate every day? As opposed to how much time you spend on Facebook. Some of y'all on Facebook while I'm talking right now. You ain't bit more attention to what I'm saying. You strolling on Facebook right now. You texting somebody right now. Oh. Don't tell me the Holy Ghost won't pick it up. But I'm trying to tell you, it's going to be the word that you need when you get in trouble. Do you have word you can draw? Do you have something you can pull on? When the enemy comes to combat or to come against your faith, do you have something you can draw on? Are y'all all right? Okay. So meditate on the word. When you go to bed at night, meditate on the word. When you wake up in the morning, I heard Mrs. Coleman say, watch, when she woke up, she started meditating on the word. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Before I get out of bed, before I go out the house, before I start dealing with other people, I meditate on the word. All the word we got, all the Facebook we got, use your phone for some good stuff. Use your phone for meditating. Use your phone for reading the word. Use your phone for listening to all these messages that Sister LaShondra put on YouTube. Go back and look at the Facebook Live. Y'all go out of here now. Use your phone for that. So we can pull down this unbelief. So we won't have to struggle and wait so long to see manifestation because we're staggering at the moment. All right, last thing he told me, I'll close here. The last thing he said to me, how do you combat the spirit of worship? He said, number four, live in worship. I said, God, what you saying? He said, my people have mistaken what worship is. I said, what are you saying? I understand what he's saying, but you know, I want to make sure I'm hearing from him. He said, my people think worship is an event. My people think worship is a song. My people think worship is two slow songs, or a song that makes you cry, or something that we do at church before the pastor preach. No. Worship don't have anything to do with a song. Worship has to do with a lifestyle. Worship has to do with how you go to work. Are you at work on time? Do you give a full 8 hour days of work? Or are you Googling and on Amazon while you're at work? Y'all ain't saying that. Worship has to do with integrity. Worship has to do with my sacrifice. Worship has to do with how I treat people. Worship has to do with how I entreat people. Worship has to do with how I handle my business affair. Worship has to do with do I pay my bills. Y'all ain't saying nothing. So he said they must live in worship. They must live that all the time. It's not when you're in church. It's not a song. If nobody ever sees it, the eyes of the Lord are in every place. He told the woman over in John chapter number 4. He told the woman, he said, God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. He wasn't talking about a song. He wasn't talking about an event. He was talking about those that live this thing and walk it out and see my glory. Those are the ones that see my faith. Those are the ones that see manifestation are one that live in the spirit and walk out in truth. Y'all all right? John 4:24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking for such to worship him, not to go to church, not to sing a slow song, not to cry. Y'all missed it. No, but I'm looking for worshipers that worship me all day long. Worship me in how they live. Worship me in how they give. Worship me in being obedient. Oh, it got quiet there. Worship me in being obedient. Worship me in sacrifice. Worship is all about sacrifice. Worship has to do with sacrifice. Present your body a living sacrifice. That's worship. Oh, you missed it. A living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, and it's just your reasonable servant, and be not transformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewal of your mind. That's worship. How you operate in your mind. Is your mind full of unbelief? Do you have an unbelieving heart? Do you have an unbelieving mind? That's worship. When I can say, God, I trust you. Don't you slay me. I still trust you because I'm walking in the finished work. Ooh. Keep your mind on Christ by celebrating who he is. That's worship. Keep your mind on Christ by celebrating who he is. That's worship. I will keep you in perfect peace. Isaiah 26:3. If your mind is stayed on me, that's worship. Worship is outside the church, y'all. Worship is all day long. My mind is on him. I'm working. I'm doing what I got to do. But I heard somebody say my mind is still on him. My mind is still on him. I'm still about the kids. I'm still about my grandkids. I'm going to work. I'm still about my spouse. Glory to God. I'm working. I'm going to the store. I'm going to the grocery store. But my mind is still on him. My mind is still elevated on him. That's worship. Worship is a lifestyle. Worship is how you live. Are y'all all right? This is how we deal with unbelief. If we stay in worship, the devil cannot bring us to a place of non-believing. Because we constantly got our mind on him. Well, Pastor, I don't see how we can do that. It takes discipline. That's why you need to fast. It takes self-control to keep your mind on him. You got to learn how to be doing something, but still got your mind on Jesus. I heard the Holy Ghost. You got to learn how to be on earth, but your head in heaven. Y'all miss that. Y'all miss that. That's what happened to Peter. That's why Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. How Peter's feet was on the earth, but his head was in heaven. And when he got that revelation, he said, flesh and blood didn't reveal that, but my Father in heaven. So Peter tapped in into heaven, even though he was still on earth. And when you stay in that type of setup and that type of alignment, there's no place for unbelief. Because you stay in tune with God. You stay in communion with God. Are y'all all right? You stay in harmony with God. You stay one with God. There's no room for unbelief. Are y'all all right? Okay, I close. I close with some of y'all been cutting me off. Yeah, I close. Yeah, I close. But I'm trying to tell us, we can conquer. We got to, if we're going to see open doors, if we're going to see manifestation, if we're going to walk in our promise, if we're going to walk in the finished work, we got to conquer that spirit of unbelief. We got to get a grip on that. Because it's short-circuiting our power and our faith. I say it's short-circuiting our power and our faith. So he said, number one, cast these things down. Number two, we got to fast off. Number three, we got to spend more time meditating on the word and less time on Facebook and less time on TikTok and Instagram and all the other things that distract us, whatever it is, TV, movies. Conversation, whatever it is, don't get mad, get glad. I'm trying to help us. I want us to walk in the weather place. I want us to walk in everything God got for us. I don't want us to lack no good thing. I want us to have everything, houses and wells and vineyards. I want us to have more than enough. I want us to walk in that large place. But we gotta cast down unbelief. That's why only Joshua and other spies brought back up unbelieving report. They said, it's giants over there. We don't believe we can take it. It was only Joshua and Caleb said we'd be able. We can take this thing. We believe. I don't care about no giant. I don't care about all these enemies. We are able. We are able to overtake it. That's the difference between believing and unbelief. Stop listening to people who talk in unbelief. Cut them off if you have to. If your right hand offends you, cut it off. That's scripture. I don't care if it's your mama. If they're talking the wrong talk, you need to withdraw yourself from that in the midst of your thing. So he said we need to fast. He said we need to cast down. He said we need to meditate. And we need to live in worship. I believe if we're engaged in these things, we'll be able to conquer that spirit of unbelief. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. I gave you people, hallelujah. I gave your people, bless your holy name. I thank you for your word tonight. I thank you for those that had ears to hear. Let this word continue to germinate as they get off this line tonight and even get into their beds. I thank you that this word will continue to stir in their spirit. When they hit the floor in the morning, this word will still be brewing in their hearts and in their spirit. Because we want to walk out the finished work. We want to walk in the finished work. We want to cease from our labor and walk in that place of rest that you have prepared for us. So thank you for your word. Thank you for those that had a heart to hear. Thank you for the good ground that word found tonight. That's a few on here that have some good ground. That word found a resting place tonight. We thank you for it now. And we shall see fruit, and we shall hear the good reports of the magnitude of the potency of this word tonight. We thank you for it tonight. Help us to walk it out. Help us to lay aside every weight and sin so we can run this race with patience. Look it up to Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Lord, we bless you tonight. We thank you for using me as a vessel just to deliver this word to your precious people. And we thank you that we shall stand as a mighty army and we shall believe the report of the Lord. We love you and we magnify you. We give your name all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you for everything that will be accomplished by the preaching and teaching of this word. It is so in Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Back into the hands of Elder Maria Jones.